Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Ave Maria Press Professional Development Webinar Series. In today's webinar, Timothy P. O'Malley will explore why the real presence matters for challenges we face as a church post-COVID-19. My name is Erin Pierce. I am the Parish and Curriculum Marketing Specialist at Ave Maria Press. I would like to recognize our webinar partners, the National Association of Catholic Family Life Ministers, the National Association for Lay Ministry, and the Catholic Campus Ministry Association. Everyone in the audience is muted today, but you are able to ask questions. Questions may be sent using the question section of the GoToWebinar panel that you see here, and I will answer Tim will answer as many of those questions as possible at the end of the presentation today. This webinar is being recorded, and a link to that recording will be sent to you via email tomorrow. With that, I would like to welcome and introduce our presenter today. Timothy P. O'Malley is a Catholic theologian, author, speaker, and the director of McGrath Theology Online at the McGrath Institute for Church Life at the University of Notre Dame. He also teaches on marriage and family, sacramental theology, and catechesis in the Department of Theology at Notre Dame. Tim, thank you so much for being with us today.
Oh, thank you so much, and welcome to all of those throughout the country who are joining in. It's great to at least see you as a number right now. So
that's right. Wonderful. I'm going to go ahead and put you in presenter mode.
Great. All right, so you all should be able to see my screen. Erin, is that correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Great.
Take it from here.
All right, well, it's a delight to be with you and to talk a little bit about this topic around what happens after COVID, linked a little bit to a recent book that we just published through the McGrath Institute and in a partnership with Ave Maria Press entitled Real Presence, What Does It Mean and Why Does It Matter? And so the question that we ask today is, what does a book like this have to do for those of us who are thinking about what happens after COVID-19 in many of our parishes, or as I have playfully called, why real presence really matters? So I wanted to say something about COVID-19 and particularly sort of, the good and the bad. Oh, let me get rid of this. So I want to say something about COVID-19, including the good and the bad, right? Roughly around a year ago today or so, the University of Notre Dame shut down and we began the lockdown that would occupy us in Indiana around 2 months. Of course, we know nationwide that other people have been locked down for far longer. It meant no Easter that year, and it meant that meant that there was a sort of good deal of spiritual longing in all of our lives. I know that I tuned in to watch the Pope's sort of extraordinary address from St. Peter's Square and the celebration of benediction and Eucharistic adoration. And so there was a sense of longing and desire, a real return to the Eucharist. I know that myself, I had grown used to going to Mass, and even all these months after the pandemic, as I'm regularly attending the Eucharist, the reception of the Blessed Sacrament is for me nothing that I don't take it for granted in the same way anymore. And yet at the same time, we know that there have also been not excellent things about the pandemic, and particularly our reliance, necessarily so perhaps, on stream masses, right? And initially a lot of people perhaps did stream those masses, and maybe people still stream those masses, but the question that a lot of people have is, will they come back, and what will they come back to? If they were sort of irregular attenders of the Mass, are they going to come back at all, right? So there is this sort of fear that we have forgotten how to be a people who are present to one another, present to God, to belong together in space and time with one another. And so I think we have to recognize that there's good and bad dimensions of this, and they offer real pastoral and theological challenges, which I'm happy to address in the question and answer period too. So this book that I composed is then accidentally intended to answer this question. For me, this book was a spiritual conversion on the part of myself. I wrote most of the book during the early days of the pandemic. I did the research for it. I longed for the Blessed Sacrament, and yet I wasn't able to receive it. And it was a return to me to an initial love with the Blessed Sacrament that I had very early in my life, but the academy had almost beaten entirely out of me. I remember so deeply my grandparents at my age of 7 or 8 being taken to the benediction of the Blessed Sacrament in our little parish, Our Lady of Fatima in Maryville, Tennessee. And I just remember so deeply the mystery of being taken into a love that was made available on that altar for me to behold in wonder. As we sang the Tantum Ergo and said the divine praises, there was something about the Eucharist that captured me, and this book reclaimed for me that initial desire. And it made me think, like, well, maybe there's something about the Eucharist, particularly at this moment in time, we can think about a renewed evangelization. So the rest of the webinar, I'm just gonna take us through some myths, some what we'll call theses for how to move forward, and some pastoral consequences. So let's start with the myths. Myth one, so every couple of years, the Pew study releases a report that says that no one believes in Eucharistic presence. It's roughly around 31% of Catholics the last time who don't really believe that the Eucharist, or only 31% do believe that the Eucharist is related to transubstantiation. Of course, there are problems with the Pew report. The language is theologically sort of wonky. It doesn't say the right thing. It says, do you believe that the Eucharist is the actual body and blood of Christ? But of course, that's not actually the doctrine of transubstantiation. It is, of course, that do you believe that it's the substantial presence of Christ, right? Which is a different thing. We'll talk about that in a moment. Nonetheless, I think for that reason, right, because of the phraseology of it, we really can't conclude necessarily, which some of us are tempted to do, that every single person is apathetic about the Eucharist, that only 69% of people really believe that the bread and wine are merely symbols and they don't know anything about Eucharistic doctrine. So I think we have to be a little less hard on ourselves and recognize that the Pew report, though really pointing towards needs for religious formation and catechesis, doesn't necessarily point to no one at all caring about the Eucharist ever. That's myth one. Myth two, doctrinal instruction alone, I suppose, will lead to the flourishing of Eucharistic devotion. So the response to this, every time this Pew report comes out, is we need to get people really to understand what the doctrines of real presence are and what transubstantiation is. And I am all in favor of that. I'm a theologian at the University of Notre Dame. I spend time getting my students to understand precisely those doctrines. But the dilemma, I think, is our assumption that a sort of intellectual understanding of these doctrines, what they are, the theology behind them, their history, will suddenly lead people to give their lives over to Eucharistic devotion. Historically in the church, that's just not how it works. It tends to work the other way, right? Devotion leads to a deeper understanding of doctrine, right? So if, for example, we're having a problem with people properly understanding the Eucharist and Eucharistic presence, perhaps the problem is actually a devotional problem, a liturgical problem, a problem of our devotion to the Blessed Sacrament as celebrated in the Eucharistic liturgy, in benediction, in Eucharistic processions. Perhaps that's the problem, and the doctrinal dimension will follow along with that. So that's myth two. Myth three, the doctrine of transubstantiation is just complicated philosophy that really just overexplains the Eucharist. Even folks I admire in sort of public theology positions, you know, folks who write for very popular magazines are prone to say this, right? Like, oh, why do we need something so complicated like transubstantiation when really like that overexplains the Eucharist? Can't we just appreciate that it's the mystery of Christ's presence? Do we really need to answer anything related to how or what it is or why it is? As we'll see in a little bit, this is just wrong. The doctrine of transubstantiation is not complicated philosophy. Most young people who have a sort of basic use of reason will be able to understand it. And actually, in understanding it, as we'll see in a bit, you actually have your whole life changed. The understanding of what the church is actually saying in transubstantiation kind of changes everything. Fourth myth, the Eucharistic presence is the same as other presence, and the poor matter just as much too. Now, the poor do matter just as much too, but it's the first problem that's a mistake, right? That Eucharistic presence is the same as other presences for Christ, right? So as we hear at the Second Vatican Council, we hear that Christ is present in the scriptures, he's present on the altar, he's present in the person of the priest, he's present in the assembly. Of course, Christ is present, we see here in Matthew 25, in the hungry and thirsty, right? This is the essential, these presences are manifold. But real presence, as we'll see in a bit, is not the same as these other presences. And they don't need, and for that reason, that presence is not in competition with these other presences. I often hear people say, you know, we're too obsessed with Eucharistic presence and we're not obsessed enough about the presence of Christ in the poor. That may be the case. There may be people who do in fact care more about Eucharistic presence and not the poor. And in that case, they're in the same problem as Pope Benedict identified many, many years ago when he said that a Eucharist that does not result in concrete acts of charity is intrinsically fragmented. That's their fault. It's a bad celebration of the Eucharist. But the Eucharistic presence is different from those other presences. It's a substantial presence. Bread and wine become totally Christ's body and blood so that we can eat and drink that body and blood and become, therefore, reshape ourselves so that we can become Christ, right? We eat and drink our Lord so that our Lord can fill us with all sorts of desire, all sorts of wonder. Okay, so those are the four myths. Now let's get then into the four theses that in essence respond to each of these myths. So this is going to take certain themes from the book. We won't go through the book as a whole. You can buy it, and I'd love for you to actually buy it. But we'll just go through some of the themes together. So first of all, Eucharistic doctrine, especially real presence, and salvation go together. The Eucharist in the history of Christianity has always been very closely linked to the body, right? To the body and materiality and to the way that we receive Christ's body and blood so that our body and blood might be transformed, right? We don't often think about that, right? When we approach perhaps in to receive the Eucharist, we don't think like, wow, my flesh and blood is going to be transformed through this encounter, right? It's not, as St. Augustine says, Christ who I'm consuming, but in fact, Christ is consuming me, taking up into him. And so really, it says something very important, each of these doctrines, about what it means to be a Christian as an embodied creature. We read in Irenaeus of Lyon, a third century theologian in his Against Heresies, our opinion or our doctrine, our teaching is in accord with the Eucharist, and the Eucharist establishes our opinion or doctrine or teaching. For we offer to him his own, announcing consistently the fellowship and union of the flesh and spirit, right? We are creatures, body and soul together. And so materiality matters, matter matters, as we'll hear in a bit. And that we eat and drink Christ's body and blood in a material way really matters. For as the bread which is produced from the earth, when it receives the invocation of God, what might be the Eucharistic prayer in Irenaeus, is no longer common bread, right? It's no longer regular bread. This is very early on. Eucharistic doctrine appears early in the church. But the Eucharist consisting of two realities, earthly and heavenly, right? It's both earthly and heavenly. What looks like bread, what looks like wine, as the later tradition will say. But of course, it is also a heavenly reality. So also our bodies, when they receive the Eucharist, are no longer corruptible, having the hope of resurrection to eternity. Notice what Irenaeus says, we are no longer corruptible. We are no longer going to be creatures who are meant to sort of just enter into the earth. While we say on Ash Wednesday, right, remember that you are dust and to dust you shall return, right? We are no longer corruptible. The totality of our lives, every part of us, all of the embodied material existence are meant to go together. The Eucharistic presence of Christ comes into this. It changes us. I always remember my grandmother was able to receive the Blessed Sacrament around a month and a half before she died. She eventually was no longer able to eat, and so it became nearly impossible for her to receive the Blessed Sacrament. And yet, this reception of the Blessed Sacrament really mattered, that that body which was dying, right, that body which was suffering, nonetheless is transformed and redeemed as she ate and drank the body of our Lord. So doctrine and salvation, dear friends, go together. Second, devotion and doctrine also go together. I think that we artificially separate devotion and doctrine, right? They can actually go together. One of my favorite authors that I talk about in my book is Mechtild of Hackenborn. She's a part of a community of religious in Helfta. It was Mechtild of Mackenborn of Hackenborn, Mechtild of Magdeburg, and Gertrude the Great of Helfta, right? So you have a whole community of religious women that were writing on the Eucharist. And Mechtild, in her religious community, there were Dominican confessors who came after St. Thomas Aquinas and after St. Albert the Great. Albert the Great wrote an amazing book on the Eucharist that I recommend to everyone. And Mechtild of Hackenborn was taught by Dominicans to understand what was happening in the Eucharist, what was happening in this presence. And this presence of Christ was linked so closely to the devotion. So all of these religious women were really created and helped develop the devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus well before Margaret Mary Alacoque, right? So well before then, you found this in the 14th century, this devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And it's precisely in Mechtild's writings that we see how much devotion and real presence go together. So she writes, the Lord summoned the soul. She's having a vision of heaven on the Feast of the Annunciation, being taken up into the heavenly liturgy and getting to receive the body and blood of Christ, and the blood of Christ directly from the heart of Christ. She summoned the soul and placed his own hand in hers, giving her all the labor and exercise of the works that he had accomplished in his holy humanity, right? So you see again, like in Irenaeus, this exchange of humanity and divinity in this communion with Christ. There he touched his gracious eyes to the soul's eyes, giving her the exercise of his own holy eyes and an abundance flow of tears. Finally, he united his honey-sweet heart to the soul's heart, granting her all his exercise of meditation, devotion, and love, right? His heart is attached to her. And through this act of communion, her soul was incorporated into Christ. And so, dear friends, this doctrine, right, what we know, what we can understand about the Eucharist, our use of reason, goes so closely together with our adoration of what is given, with our desire for the Lord. We don't have to understand these as obstacles to one another, but as mutually communicating with one another. The more that we know who is present in the Blessed Sacrament, the more that we desire to receive him. And the more that we desire to receive him, the more we desire to know him. This leads then into thesis three, which is the pastoral doctrine of transubstantiation. This might be the most surprising thing I'm going to say, right? Transubstantiation, supposedly abstract, right? It's best known transubstantiation through St. Thomas Aquinas, who is not the first person who uses it. The church taught the aptness of transubstantiation starting in 1215, or the Fourth Lateran Council. And transubstantiation is simply the doctrine that the bread and the wine become at the level of substance, that is, what they really are. Substance is not visible in philosophy in the church, right? It's not what's touchable, tangible, it's something's isness. You can't always see the isness, right? Right? You can't always see like justice. You see particular manifestations of justice. You see this act of justice, but you don't see justice itself, right? So what this is, right? Bread and wine, its isness in all of its isness becomes the body and blood of Christ, right? It becomes united to the flesh and blood of Christ. It is Christ, or not even united with it. It is it, right? It's transformed at that moment. But it's a very important doctrine, right? Because it doesn't lead to the opposite conclusion, which is that really then we are doing nothing more but eating human flesh and human blood, right? The doctrine is incomplete if you just know that it's transformed. You also need to know about the accidents or the species, the form, what it looks like, right? Accidents are the like height, what it tastes like, its color. Right, what St. Thomas teaches about the Eucharist, right, is that the accidents through a miracle remain. In other words, Christ wants to give his whole self to us, to belong to us, as he said at the Last Supper, "This is my body and this is my blood," right? He wants us to remember this through eating and drinking at this, as we'll see, this most festive banquet. And yet Christ gives us in a way that we can receive it, right? We don't eat human flesh and human blood. We eat bread and wine. And so the signs of bread and wine remain. They are maintained by God, bestowed to us by God, right? And we get a glimpse, right, of what creation itself will become. Right? Remember what we said in our first thesis. The body matters in through the Eucharist. Our bodies are transformed. We are brought into sort of eternal life. But in the Eucharist, we see the future of all creation, right? All creation is meant to be in God. God is meant to be all in all. The whole world is meant to be infused with this real presence. And the Eucharist is that first sacrament, that sacramental foretaste that allows us to start to see a world that is fully redeemed. Of course, St. Thomas writes about all of this in his Summa Theologia, but you don't have to just turn there. He's the author of these beautiful hymns for the Feast of Corpus Christi, including Laudes Zion, which I do a more intensive study of in the book, right? The dogma is given to Christians, that is transubstantiation, that bread is changed into flesh and wine into blood, right? What you do not understand nor see, right? You cannot understand it. You cannot see it. That's what I said. Transubstantiation is not just a philosophical doctrine. It's not an explanation of how the Eucharist becomes body and blood. A strong faith makes firm. You give yourself over it. You learn to see what's there to be seen through devotion, through bending the knee before the host. Under diverse species, that is what looks like bread and what looks like wine, signs alone and not the things, not the realities themselves. It hides remarkable realities. Flesh is food. Blood is drink. The whole Christ, he's given to us wholly under each species. So it's not, this is a really important thing, because it means that, you know, when Christ is in the tabernacle, it's not that we are locking Jesus up and now Christ is like, oh, I'm in the tabernacle, I can't get out, why are you locking me up? Rather, that particular piece of matter has been transformed into the personal presence of our Lord. It's why we kneel before the tabernacle. It's why we participate in Eucharistic processions. It's why we adore that. It has been forever transformed. And now, right, it's the same invitation to us. Will we let our lives be forever transformed by the presence of our Lord? Last thesis, thesis four. The more we adore Christ in the Eucharist, the more we are called to the poor. So I think this is the myth that I'm most concerned about, dear friends, in some ways, the myth that to adore Christ in the Eucharist, to look with wonder upon him, to receive the Blessed Sacrament in our hearts, and to really be concerned about the presence of Christ means that we don't care about the hungry and thirsty. And I think we have to recognize that this is just, this is false. It's a modern false assumption that the whole tradition speaks out against. You know, in a million ways, we could read Catherine of Siena, who dealt with those who were suffering from plagues in hospitals, or Rose of Lima, who had a deep Eucharistic devotion and yet nonetheless cared for those who were in hospitals. They were linked to her. Her Eucharistic devotion and her caritas or love were linked. But in my book, I talk about Dorothy Day. And of course, what I love about Dorothy Day, particularly in her work, Loaves and Fishes, although this quote below is from her autobiography, The Long Loneliness. What I love about Dorothy Day is the devoutness of Eucharistic life connected to the radicality of hospitality. Dorothy Day offers no sort of saccharine vision of poverty. She shows it for all that it is, for all the suffering that it induces. And yet at the same time, she shows that the Christian life, the house of hospitality, the Catholic worker is run through a hospitality that is previously received from our Lord, right? It's the hospitality of the Eucharistic sacrifice. Dorothy Day at all her farms would have the high masses celebrated with chant and incense, because she knew that this adoration of our beloved Lord was connected so closely to love of those without home, to the love of those who often demanded a good deal of Dorothy Day. So she writes at the end of The Long Loneliness, her autobiography, "We cannot love God unless we love each other. And to love, we must know each other. We know him in the breaking of the bread," right, in the Eucharist. "And we know each other in the breaking of the bread," right? So the theme in my book, this connection of real presence, is so closely linked to sacrifice, and of course, the sacrifice of the whole church, right? Because what's present in the Eucharist, of course, is the whole Christ, Christ's body and soul. But that includes the church, right? There we see in union all those who are in union with him, all those who are on the margins and who suffer. And we know each other in the breaking of the bread. We are not alone anymore. Heaven is a banquet and life is a banquet too, even with a crust where there is companionship, right? That's even in the difficulties of life, there is this companionship. We have known the long loneliness and we have learned that the only solution is love. And that love comes with community, right? To receive our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament is to be called into a more radical relationship with the church, and a more radical relationship, therefore, with all those men and women who suffer, who are on the margins, who cry out in sorrow, right? These days, we belong to them. The more I recognize and desire the presence of Christ, the more I am attuned to see Christ present in those among us who have not. Okay, so then four consequences and a little return to COVID, which sounds terrible, but a little return to sort of thinking through COVID. First, consequences. So how do we then restore this deep sense of Eucharistic devotion in parish, diocesan, and school life? First off, we need to remember that matter matters. I think that probably the number one problem with Eucharistic devotion is that we forgot that matter matters, that materiality matters. I have this somewhat salacious image for you to look at. It's the fire screen Madonna. It was either a Eucharistic altarpiece from around the 14th century, or if not a Eucharistic altarpiece, a devotion for the Eucharist. And it shows Mary actually very provocatively offering her breast to Christ. The materiality of that, Christ is laid out in a kind of strange way. The original image showed him actually fully bared, including his genitals. He's on a white cloth, which is meant to sort of serve as an image of a kind of corporal upon the altar. Of course, Mary herself is often described as a kind of altar in such artistic imagery. The breast itself, which is milk, is offered to us even in late medieval society, milk was understood as congealed blood from the breast, right? So the blood was transformed and it was fed. So it's an image of kind of us as children receiving milk, but that milk is already blood. And of course, there are specific images of the Eucharist around us, including the chalice. And of course, you can see the missal on Mary's sort of couch being sort of moved by wind, which is often an image of the Spirit. Right? Imagine contemplating this all the time when you receive the Blessed Sacrament, right? An image like this. Because we don't look at images like this, because we don't often listen to music that does this kind of things, we often don't have this kind of devotion. The recognition of the real scandal of the Eucharist is that the word became flesh and dwelt among us in all of that fleshiness, and yet that flesh is still given to us in the Blessed Sacrament here and now, that the tender feeding of us with his very presence, right? So the more that we employ images and matter, the more that we form people to, with their bodies, to adore Christ and to recognize what it means to be a body who adores Christ and to be present before our Lord, it really does increase devotion. It infuses people with a new Eucharistic vision. Number two, devotion matters. So I grew up in a time in which people often said the Eucharist is for eating and not for adoring. And that's just, to me, wrong. It's wrong because the Eucharist is for eating and for adoring, right? How could we not adore the presence of our Lord who comes to feed us, right? How can we not increase such devotion, right? Like, look at this beautiful altar, dear friends, with all the candles and the Blessed Sacrament and the flowers. You know, all I said matter matters. Well, devotion matters because and devotion requires matter. So it reveals to us what the Eucharist is, to kneel before the Eucharist, to see incense, to see the candles, to see all of this really matters. And so I think one of the things post-COVID is, are we willing to reclaim in our parishes in more intensive ways, regular celebration of benediction of the Blessed Sacrament? We are not returning to the pre-conciliar era where we feared that many people understood benediction of the Blessed Sacrament as better or more or something like that than the Mass. People get today that the Mass is really essential. Such enough so that even when the pandemic happened, we didn't cancel Mass. Our thing wasn't, well, let's get together in small communities and pray the scriptures, right? We would watch the Mass. So we have a sense that the Mass really matters. But this period of devotion, of benediction of the Blessed Sacrament, I think matters for parish life. It's actually a great space of evangelization for people who are just coming in. They can come, they can look, they can wonder. They can see that something remarkable is happening without feeling actually too left out and without actually dedicating an hour to their lives. So the more that we can kind of do this sort of commitment to devotion, the more it matters. Can we be devoted to the Blessed Sacrament? Will we have benediction? Just one more example. My son is receiving his first communion this year, and the number way I'm teaching him, I'm not teaching him the doctrine of transubstantiation because he's seven, or he's eight now, and I will teach him the doctrine of transubstantiation. He knows that Christ is really present in the Eucharist. But I am teaching him how to genuflect before the Blessed Sacrament and why genuflection is so essential and who is the Lord that's made present, right? So that kind of devotion really matters, and it forms and cultivates our imagination. Consequence three, festivity matters. Y'all, when we can get together, we got to get together and we got to have processions. And we got to recognize the presence of our Lord in history and how that festivity has transformed everything. In my book, I write about the Feast of Corpus Christi. And once upon a time, the Feast of Corpus Christi had a number of historical, or had a mystery plays, or plays that were associated with it, in which the whole history of Christian salvation was proclaimed, in which the beauty of the city entered into this festive time to welcome in summer through the presence of the Blessed Sacrament. I really think this matters, and I think particularly as we're working with Latino or Latina communities, right? The more that we can sort of engage in popular Catholicism and recognize that the church has a vocation within the world, that the Blessed Sacrament is not meant simply to be locked up into that church, but is to transform every dimension of history, right? God's presence dwelling among us with flowers from heaven and songs that are sung. This festivity really matters. And I think it's going to be really important post-COVID when all we want to do is get together and no longer be on Zoom or go to webinar meetings. Though I'm grateful you joined me today. Lastly, doctrine matters, right? My book is full of doctrine. It's full of an explanation of the scriptural foundations of this doctrine, of early church understanding, of how St. Thomas transforms it and how this doctrine gets lived in the spiritual life. But I think this doctrine can be presented, right, as Pope Francis always reminds us, as charismatic. It can be presented in such a way that we really give to people, perhaps in study groups in our parishes, in our formal sort of study of Eucharistic doctrine, if we can study it together, but so that it matters to us, that the meaningful dimensions of it occur, right? That transubstantiation isn't just philosophy. It's all that I said earlier under that sort of claim about why it's not just philosophy and why it's the most pastoral, really, of doctrines. So, dear friends, in conclusion, we, God willing, are nearing the end of this global pandemic. And many of you will be asking yourselves, will people come back? And the answer to that question is, well, some won't. But those who do will have missed the presence of our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. And of course, in the community, in the church, right? But that particular and special presence of our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. And I conclude with a hymn from Thomas, or a short antiphon, I should say, just to note what possibilities are ahead for us. O sacrum convivium, O sacred banquet, right? We're meant to belong together in this banquet, right? Don't we pray at each Mass, behold the Lamb of God, behold he who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb, right? The supper of the Lamb, which is that great wedding banquet, right? This is the sacred banquet there. How scandalous, right? Really, in our parishes, throughout every world, there is performed that sacred banquet in quo Christus sumitor, in which Christ is consumed or supped upon, consumed, right? We receive Christ, right? This banquet, this festive gathering of men and women who come together, not out of their own projects, but out of a presence that calls them and binds them together into one unity of love, right? So in which Christ is consumed, the memory of his passion is recalled, that love that's revealed on the cross every time the sacrifice of the Mass is celebrated, and certainly his resurrection and his ascension into heaven. The memory of this passion is recalled. It's made manifest here and now in what looks like bread and wine. And yet in eating it, mens impleto gratia, the mind is filled with grace. We're full of the gift, right? Remember what grace is. It's gift. It's the gift of God who gives manna from heaven, who gives and gives and gives, who's not in for tit for tat exchanges, but who gives. And the pledge of future glory, our future life together as those who will forever feast upon the face of our Lord, right? The pledge of future glory is given to us. Alleluia. I'll say that. It's in the text. I know it's Lent, but just call me a rebellious creature. So this is, I think, dear friends, that this provides a vision for us sort of post-COVID. We do long to be together to celebrate that supper of the Lamb. And what we offer to people, right, even in inviting them back, will they come back? Well, I hope so. They'll come back the more we make clear to us that what we do is not like just any gathering of any community that just happens to do something that looks like bread and wine, but we're really consuming our blessed Lord. And we're recalling the memory of his suffering, his life and death, a memory that transforms what it means to be human. Right now, our memories enter into that memory. And we're filled with grace, with a gift of love that we cannot even give voice to. And of course, we receive a foretaste of what we're called to. The supper of the Lamb. And dear friends, I think that's what I most long for, not just after COVID, but entirely. And our invitation to folks is to renew this devotion so that they can belong once more, so that they can adore the Lord together in the communion of the church. So that is my presentation, and now I'll turn it back over to Aaron.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Tim. I invite any of you to please submit questions for Tim. I really feel like you've expressed so much of what many of us feel, right? That hunger to be back, to commune together, to receive the body of Christ, and also that maybe kind of apprehension or fear, are others, you know, are people going to come back to the parish? And I guess your answer to that is we just don't know.
Well, right. I mean, I think people will come back. I think there are a lot of people who probably realize that they didn't miss it. And of course that, you know, there's lots of issues with this. I'm only talking about one, right? We have to deal with hospitality and welcoming people back and actually let people know that they're welcome. Of course, all of this is guided by a Eucharistic vision, right? We're not welcoming them back into the Lions Club. It's not like we're the Boy Scouts and we're concerned about our numbers dropping because we're not going to be able to run the troop anymore, right? Like the point is we want to welcome them into communion, right? And so that's, I always think like the Catholics come home, commercials get half of it right. They're like, Catholics come home. And I'm like, well, to what? And we forget the part that's like, you're coming home to communion, to a love that transcends everything. And so I do think we need to be very clear about that and perhaps understand it ourselves. For those of us who have stayed or who are waiting for people to return, to really go out and to proclaim this with a bit more precision.
Absolutely. So we've got some questions coming in here. Let's see. Patricia says, we are concerned about keeping our parish open. Wrong thought?
Well, of course, it's a concern. I mean, I'm not quite sure of the context of the question. So if it's like you're concerned about keeping it open, less it closed because of the pandemic, Right. Of course, we would be sad for that, right? We would be sad for the closure of a parish that couldn't receive the Blessed Sacrament anymore. And so, but of course, I think spiritual communion really matters. This is part of what I'm hinting at, right? One of my least favorite things that was said during the pandemic is that masses were canceled. No, they weren't. Mass was still celebrated, and public Eucharistic liturgies were canceled, but the presence of our Lord was still there. And so in that sense, right, if our parishes are closed again, if we have to go home, or God forbid, we have another pandemic in like 2 years and we run through this whole situation again, you know, the presence of our Lord is there and we can sort of commune with him. And of course, I mean, if the question is like, I'm concerned our parish won't survive financially, I understand that. That's a very big concern. And I think it's not just an issue though of attracting people, of course, that's necessary, but it's belonging, right? The reason why the losing our parish would be so intensely painful, because it's precisely the place where we do most encounter our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament and in each other in a similar way. So I think it's a fear. Yeah, you should be afraid. But fear is also the beginning of action. So don't stop with fear and trepidation, but we're human beings who have freedom and can act, and so feel free to do something. Mm-hmm.
Sylvia asks, when does transubstantiation actually occur within the Mass?
Well, in the Roman Catholic tradition, in the Roman Catholic sort of canon law, it occurs after one speaks at the bread, "This is my body." And at that moment, in the memory of Christ, or because we speak Christ's word and his promise to us in the Gospels, that when you do this in memory of me, then this shall take place. So in the Mass, this is my body for what once was bread and is now body. And this is the blood of the new covenant, right? At this moment, Christ is present.
Okay, wonderful. Let's see. Deborah says, I've got parents excited to come back for First Communion with their children, and they're inviting others to return to celebrate.
That's beautiful. Yeah, I think I know that my own child, as he prepares for his First Communion, is once again representing the Eucharist to me.
Yes, so you kind of...
You
get it. Yep. Continue your love. Yeah, so that might be a way that we can get the parents to come back, obviously, through their children and through the sacramental process.
Yeah, I think desire is key. I wish we would talk more about desire in sort of Eucharistic preparation. The children, right, my 8-year-old is so interested in receiving the Eucharist right now, and he really desires it. And I think we have to say something like, man, if you too could learn this desire, right? I mean, if we all could learn this desire to desire like an 8-year-old to receive the Blessed Sacrament, what a gift.
For sure. Joyce said, would it be helpful for preachers to focus on the healing power of the Eucharist as people begin to return and bring with them the pain of loss from what they have endured over the past year? How could that be expressed?
Yeah, I mean, I think the Eucharist is healing. Yeah, you can certainly focus, I think, on the healing dimensions, and it can be preached upon. Right? I mean, I think that's what I was pointing towards, is the Eucharist is the presence of Christ that enters into our body, and our bodies are, we've perhaps learned the fragility of our bodies in a particular kind of way that we had forgotten, right? That we, when we receive the Blessed Sacrament, you know, we are receiving life, and the life that gives life to our life. And so we can't necessarily, of course, guarantee that we will, or we can't guarantee that we'll live forever, right? And so I think the more that we speak about healing, and that this actually is preparation for life with Christ, there's so many wounds, right? And I guess if you're really thinking about healing dimensions of the Eucharist, of course, it's also this deeper social solidarity that Pope Francis speaks so well about, right? We're brought together in communion, right? Like the thing about illness that's terrible is not only are you sick, you're actually cut off from each other, right? That's the worst part of illness, right? You're cut off. You're a pariah. You know, if you have COVID, no one's even supposed to like get near you, right? So you're a pariah, you're cut off. Of course, we've lost so many human beings. We've been apart from each other. We've missed so many things. And so in the presence of Christ that we gather around, that healing is made available to us in the Blessed Sacrament. We're brought together in social solidarity and love. And of course, it's also healing linked to racial injustice and other dimensions of social life that we've really come to recognize as having huge problems right now. Right? Like, who can heal that? Of course, we can, but we need the presence of Christ, right? The glorious presence of our Lord, who can form us to recognize Christ in this way. So yeah, I mean, preaching on that would be great. I mean, preaching on the Eucharist regularly would be a great gift. I think you could, for example, do regular benediction with preaching and actually focus on Eucharistic preaching for a little while within the church. And of course, this summer, because we're reading the Gospel of Mark, you get many weeks of John 6, the Bread of Life discourse. And so it's a great opportunity for priests and catechists and in parishes to really attend to, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you shall not have life within you.
Mary asks, do you have suggestions for a parish whose pastor is not into adoration? He's not against having it, but has nothing to do with it himself.
Well, I mean, priest stuff is always hard. I mean, priests are kind of independent agents. This sounds really terrible, but have him call me. I'm serious. I mean, I think there are certain approaches to adoration that I find more complicated, right? So we can sometimes view adoration as a chance to like really like move our affections, this sort of youth ministry approach where the goal is to get people to just feel so much that they think Christ is present there. I don't understand why present churches today, in a world where we're inundated with sound, image, perpetual noise, couldn't understand why men and women might want to spend time alone with the Blessed Sacrament in silence, in adoration. And, you know, if the priest isn't interested, that's not great. On the other hand, the rite can be celebrated without a priest, and the benediction can't, and it would be great if he would actually be present for the benediction. So for that reason, have him call me.
All right.
So now I'm going to get a phone call from Father so-and-so complaining that about me. But that's fine. It won't be my first phone call.
That's right. Couple, you mentioned festivity matters, right? What are some ways, Magdalene asks, to emphasize the festivity of exposition and benediction, either through personal devotion or parish activity, music, reflections?
Yeah, all silence? Those things. So benediction, there's a book for the worship of the Eucharist outside of Mass that allow all these things, right? You can celebrate it in the context of the Liturgy of the Hours. You can have music that allows for sort of periods of silence. You can celebrate, like, you can, of course, there's the festivity of the rite itself, right? Incense is festive for most of us because we never use it. You know, as an altar server, I have to admit, the only time I regularly got to use incense as a 10-year-old boy deeply interested in fire was in benediction of the Blessed Sacrament. And so, you know, like that was the time in which incense was present. And there were flowers, right? Flowers and song and all these things. And so light, candle, the use of light and darkness, this sort of festivity, I think is essential. And like really upping our game on Corpus Christi. American parishes, in my assessment, especially sort of the Anglo versions, are so bad at celebrating most feasts that are not Christmas and Easter, right? So Christmas is a big deal because everyone comes. Easter's a big deal. Corpus Christi, we still want to get people out in around 45 minutes to an hour. You know, Pentecost, the same thing. Take some time. Like, if you have a parish picnic or carnival, do it in June this year. I recognize that that's probably not going to happen then this year. But in 2022, right? So find ways to be festive together in the Eucharistic celebration. And if you have additional ideas, send them along to me. I'm always gathering them. I think the more festive we can be, great. I am in the middle of planning with a colleague of mine a musical version of the old Corpus Christi mystery plays. So we're going to try to get parishes to start performing these mystery plays, which tell the whole life of Christ. So around so that we can have this sort of really public festive dimension and playful artistic dimension to it.
Oh, we'll look forward to that for sure. Emily asks, how can we inspire devotion to the Eucharist for those who only went to Mass for Christmas, Easter, and now post-pandemic do not plan to go back at all?
Yeah, I mean, so the way to do this is to reflect, I think, on our own devotion. I mean, we can't force people to have devotion. You can't. I've been a teacher now for 10 years, and I've learned I can't force people to do anything, right? And so, you know, like, how do you inspire devotion? Well, I mean, I guess I'm supposed to answer, it would probably be wise, like, give them my book, but right, is that
we'll
helpful?
Talk about that. We'll talk about that in a minute.
Okay, great. That's one of the ways to do it. But secondarily, you know, I think like our devotion really matters and how we talk about it. I'll just give an example. So I don't refer to the Eucharist as it anymore. And I don't even always just refer it to the Eucharist, but the way I talk about the Eucharist is as our Lord or the Blessed Sacrament. I want them to hear the weirdness of my words, right? And this is an academic conversion for me, because again, I was formed in a traditional sort of liturgical sacramental theology program. I was told that you shouldn't focus so much on Eucharistic presence, right? You shouldn't objectify the Eucharist. And yet, like, I don't know, like, I was just wrong. I was super, super wrong. And like, I remember we used to say at benediction, O sacrament, most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be ever glory thine. And when I think about that kind of relationship to the Blessed Sacrament, it changes me and it changes the way I talk about it. That means that I'm going to talk about it differently with my students who don't often go to Mass. I'm going to talk about it differently with my family and my kids, everything. So that devotion changed me. Like I said, this book really was for me a conversion. I don't often write where I'm led to conversion, but this one was.
Wow. So it really starts with us in many ways. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's talk a little bit. I wonder if you could share with us a little bit about the McGrath Institute and its purpose and mission.
Absolutely. So the McGrath Institute is an institute at the Notre Dame that connects the church and the academy to one another. And we serve as a bridge. So we seek to make the resources of the University of Notre Dame, the theological and spiritual life, and to make that available to folks who are involved in the pews, in parishes, and schools, so that they can form Catholic leaders for this new evangelization, right? So how do we form the next generation of Catholic leaders or people who are ready in Catholic leadership to invite people into the wonderful mystery of divine love that we've been talking about? So that's the mission of the Institute. We obviously have courses, we teach online courses, we have programs that you used to be able to come to in the summer when we used to travel. And of course, we publish a good deal, as you can see right in front
mm-hmm.
of you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so you've been talking about the real presence here. And we heard a couple weeks ago from Carolyn Pirtle from the other book in this series, 10 Ways to Pray. And I love the size, the manageability of these books, yet the great quality and content, of course. And I was thinking as you were presenting, you know, if we're going to help people grow to understand, love, and adore the Eucharist, this could certainly be an excellent place to start for a parish, small group study, maybe a parish mission. We will have a free downloadable study guide that can go along or discussion guide that can go along with this. So we always like to offer a discount for those of you. And if anybody would be interested in a bulk purchase, certainly you can contact me at avemariapress.com. Tim, do you want to say anything else about this?
Yeah, and if you do a bulk purchase, I'll come talk.
Mm-hmm.
At least via Zoom now. It's so easy, right? We just pop in Zoom or go to webinar. And so if you do a bulk one, let me know. I'm more than happy to chat with you.
Awesome. Wonderful. So code is webinar 0309 when ordering at avemariapress.com. And we also, and this would also apply to Off the Hook, another book that Tim wrote, God, Love, Dating, and Marriage in a Hookup world. And this is good through the 19th of March. Thank you so much, Tim, for spending your time with us and sharing your love and passion with us, as well as everybody who attended today, for your attentiveness and for your questions. I would like to invite you, well, reminder, tomorrow I will send you the recording of the webinar via email, and you can find all of our webinar recordings at avemariapress.com. And please join us next week. James Papandrea will be discussing the treasures of Mary's heart through the mysteries of the Rosary. So thank you so much. Everybody have a great day, and thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.